water levels had started to lower in the marshes of the north. Ken and his kind, the saltwater crocodiles, had killed more fish than they could devour. Kintala the dingo had discovered for the first time the strange creatures who had invaded the territory of his father, Paraji. Back at the red flying foxes, stuck together on their branches above the mangrove, not long before, there had been a season of sexual frenzy. Then the gestating females had formed their own colony. In protecting her from her own son, and then in playing with him, Kudla, the isolated kangaroo, had shown to Kartanya what a marvelous companion he would make if she would grant him some favors. All this, Paraji projected on the Dome of Dreams. For it is in this way we enter life when our dream begins. Great savanna that each day becomes more and more parched, the horizon starts to tremble. Coming from the bottom of the world, a group of one-humped camels enter the scene and invade the dream of Paraji. Drives the herd. His name is Artui, the one who knows, the initiator. Artui runs on the side. Sometimes, through the fault of only one, the group loses its cohesion. Then he must stop the cavalcade and bring back the undisciplined one towards the main part of the troop. Artui takes advantage of this to grant a few moments of rest to his troop. Then he decides that the rest has lasted long enough. They must restart the long march. This long walk, Artui's ancestors had started in the 19th century. They came from India, Pakistan, the Arabian Peninsula. 10 to 12,000 of them had been imported between 1860 and 1907 to help the pioneers open up the Great Central Plain, the Outback. Then, when motorized vehicles proved to be more useful, they left the camels there. Today, more than 100,000 camels have returned to the wilds and have appropriated the Great Crimson Savanna. The camels have finally come to a region where Artui judges the nourishment to be sufficiently abundant. Some young males are bursting with an energy too long contained. They become crazy. The strongest torment the weakest. These games do not undermine Artui's authority, who signals with a frothy drool which leaves through his lips and through his enormous hump. He is the largest and the most powerful of the camels. As far as he can see in the direction of Mount Artula, he doesn't see any rival coming. On the other side of the sacred rock, Paraji and his children search for some good fortune throughout the plain. The grasses, not long ago so supple, now crack and break under the cushions of their paws. Waka, the young female, takes pleasure in annoying her brother, to whom, in theory, she must respect. In order to have peace, Kintala pretends to be submissive. Kintala knows that in reality, in the miniature pack that forms his family, he has to bow only in front of one master, his father. Paraji makes fun of the adolescent quarrels. Waka assaults her brother again in order that Paraji's leniency be encouraged. Kintala is fed up. He would really like to put his sister in her place, but he prefers the pre-established dominations to those that must be conformed to by force. The argument turns to his disadvantage. Soon, Paraji joins himself with Waka and bites him cruelly. Paraji doesn't miss any occasion to lord it over his son, in whom he sees, whether right or wrong, a potential rival. Waka throws herself into the chase of her humiliated brother. The young female is the stronger, more rapid than before. Her fallen ear has straightened out. Her muscular line has been defined. Kintala has moved away, provoking the frustration of his sister who is searching for him. When Paraji rejoins his son, he finds him busy at digging up the earth. Waka, who had been distracted by the scents of the plain, looks over her shoulder towards her brother. Paraji always assists in the excavation work. But Waka has no doubt that under this pile of sand, there is a coveted treasure. The young female starts to dig up the hole, but her brother doesn't want her to do it. Paraji moves himself away with indifference. He knows that there is nothing in the bottom of the hole. When he comes back, Waka and Kintala are still trying to finish their quarrel. Suddenly, the young male becomes disinterested in the object of the conflict and starts sniffing the genitals of his sister. Since Waka has decided to do what she wants, Kintala engages in a ritual of domination that will take the form of a simulated coupling. The symbolic behavior of Kintala has served its purpose. It's really him who masters the situation and reclaims the whole. Waka has only to move away and attempt to prepare a new trick elsewhere that will test her brother. To the south, there is an isle placed in the middle of the waters, some miles from the continental bank. Isolated, protected, reclusive. It had never been confronted by an invasion of rabbits, foxes, or other harmful species introduced by man from the other end of the world. It's there that the western gray kangaroos, Kartanya and her son Pogo, lived among the Tamar wallabies. A young male named Kudla was smitten by Kartanya. He courted her, doing everything in order to show himself to be of a protective and paternal fiber. Yam, the slow son of Burka, brooded over his vexation at having been deprived of the pleasure of nursing. But Burka reserved from this time on the best care for the new baby that was growing heavy in her pouch. For Pogo, it's time to play. But instead of fussing over him, Kartanya brushes up against the nose of Kudla, a gesture of tenderness and of familiarity. Then, and only then, she does the same with her son. Kartanya finally accepts, but Kudla seems to want to stop her, as if he fears for her, the little punches of Pogo. In effect, with kangaroos, the word play means boxing. Kudla moves Pogo away and looks over his shoulder towards Kartanya, who seems to approve of him. During her turn, she goes towards her son and obliges him to move away. One more time, Pogo attempts his chance. One more time, he is snubbed. It is only left for him to spit out his rage on the poor innocent wallabies. Today, Paraji's life is going to be troubled deeply. Nevertheless, all begins normally. With his children Waka and Kintala, the dingo digs up a trail in the grasses, which are so dry that from this point on, a simple spark could produce a sheet of fire. Suddenly, Paraji picks up an odor of fresh flesh, so attractive that he doesn't pay attention to the young stranger that appears at his side. It's a little female that has never roamed around in the vicinity until now. The unknown arrives at the same time as Paraji to the carcass of a great kangaroo, and suddenly, the mother of the intruder has rejoined her daughter with the speed of a boomerang, of which she will carry on the name, Kira. Another small one accompanies her, a male. Quiri, the daughter of Kira, has already started to eat. Her name means the maligned, the astute. Kintala doesn't want to be bothered by these events and is thinking only about opening more deeply the hide of the kangaroo. Paraji feels troubled. Kira intimidates him, he who has never feared anybody. Helpless, he moves away, as if to take a little step back. Quiri is unrelentless at the natural orifices of the kangaroo. In this way, she has understood that that is the easiest way to open the carcass. Paraji comes back to the feast. He observes the guests with perplexity and is immediately attacked. A few seconds were enough for Kira to avert Paraji. No one participates in the banquet without an invitation. She must also warn Waka. Petrified in front of his daughter, who implores him, Paraji assists in the chastisement as a simple spectator. Kira returns to the carcass. She considers herself to be the owner because she has just humiliated in front of his own children, the one who was the leader of the pack until her arrival. In tearing up the fibrous flesh of the kangaroo, Kira feels a vague desire for Paraji, who has been shamed and who would like at least to fill his stomach. Pushed out one more time, Paraji leaves Kira to concentrate on her meal. Distracted by her own appetite, the female has not seen the return of Paraji, so discreet and with his tail lowered. She decides, then, to force him to submit to her. He must lay down in front of her. The rapid victory of Kira marks the end of Paraji's reign. It's her from now on that will govern the territory if she decides to stay. The son of Kira, Marty, comes to swat at some scraps of flesh. His mother lays into him. Then into her daughter, Query. In this way, she will have assaulted successively Waka, Paraji, and her own children, Marty and Query. Kintala will be the only one to have escaped these demonstrations of force by Kira. She eats close to him, without even a grunt. Encouraged, Kintala dives into the neck of the kangaroo that Kira had cut up. When he lifts up his head, the female is no longer there. She is walking in the surrounding savanna, quietly, like a proprietor taking the gait of a surveyor in order to evaluate her domain. A little later, Paraji will return alone and lie down close to the dead beast. He feels himself suddenly demoted to the same rank as the carcass, inside a hostile desert. Paraji still ignores it, but Kira, the female dominatrix, is not alone to find the territory of the dingo to her liking. Other nomads have stopped. Close to the females that are breastfeeding their young, some young males have hung down their vocal flap over the corner of their lips. This fold of skin is formed by the voluntary swelling of the part of the palate. It serves to show status, mainly if it's accompanied by seeing them ritualistically biting the ear of the one who they are sizing up. Some camels are recovering from the fatigue of the long marches, while others, already revigorated, surrender themselves to the great pleasure of the world, inhaling the hindquarters of a female and greedily circulating the aroma in their nasal passages. The resinous secretions of certain trees achieve also a great success. The same as that of the most rugged bark on which it is so agreeable to scratch oneself or to torture one's parasites. Some young males run after the chance to show their sexual excitement. They have to pursue all potential rivals. A little drooling from the muzzle is highly recommended. Other than the white foam from his mouth and the black fat that is secreted from the glands at the back of his neck, the main male urinates on his own tail. This work is made easier by a holstered penis directed towards the behind. A younger one would be content to mimic, even with his comrades, the coupling postures that are suggested by instinct. The idea is to spread out as much urine and excrement as possible with the help from his tail. One would then move away with a supple and detached walk, as if one had finally become, by one's own merits, the true king of the troop. The carcass is still there, where Query, the little female dingo, directs herself. The daughter of Kira grabs hold of a bit of flesh, these entrails that will nourish her own life. Paraji rejoins her, followed by his daughter, Waka, and by Marty, the son of Kira. The day before, it happened that each one found his rank in the group augmented by the three new individuals. The degradation imposed by Kira on Paraji's family and the agitation that has followed has not permitted them to try the best part of the dead kangaroo. But today, the calm has come back, and each one eats with a better appetite. Kira, who arrives unexpectedly, doesn't seem to want to spoil the party. Kintala and Marty get to know each other. They play at scrapping with each other, but the oldest is careful not to abuse his strength. Paraji, after looking at Kira to ensure she's not offended, plunges himself into the decaying carcass. Waka, who is satisfied, tires already, while her father attacks the entrails. While Kintala, after leaving his new friend, comes to sample his part of the booty. Some object of curiosity has attracted the largest of the pack towards the mound situated in close proximity. When the others come back, Paraji seems surprised. Kira has already succeeded in integrating Waka among her own children. Upon her return, Kira does not show any aggressiveness towards Kintala. She just sniffs him. The carcass has lost all interest for Kintala. As a game, he brings from afar some entrails that his sister Waka pulls away from him in flight. Paraji works feverishly away at the great kangaroo, as if he wanted to kill it for a second time, as if the plains, once again, would belong to no one but him. In the coastal zone in the north of Australia lives the largest crocodile in the world, the saltwater crocodile. We call him Salty because he can tolerate saltwaters which mingle with the freshwaters of his environment. In the same waters as the Salty swims the barramundi, one of the most strange Australian fish, where the males become females at the age of 6 years. The lowering of the water levels asphyxiates the barramundis, who wriggle in the sediment of billabongs. These are the permanent ponds that take the place of certain twists and turns of the river when its water runs dry. When the water becomes so low, there is no hunting or fishing, just pickings. The clacking of their mouths will resonate again for some moments until they fill their stomachs to the size of a basketball. Thank you. The common wallaroo, also called the wallaroo of New South Wales, is one of the most common inhabitants known in Australia and occupies the entire surface with the exception of the southern coast. It was one of the first macropods that were observed by the explorers who came from Europe in the 18th century. The wallaroo drinks from the same watering hole as some zebra finch. Normally, the animals belonging to the family of kangaroos get part of their need for water thanks to the vegetation that they consume. But when all is dry and withered, the least puddle becomes a treasure. The last days have been hard for Paraji, who in a few hours has lost the essentials of his authority, confiscated by Kira. At least he can still, as if for reassurance, intimidate his own son, Kintala. Kira still doesn't show any sign of aggressiveness towards the young dingo, who puts himself before her, even though he is supposed to obey her. The two young females, Waka, the elder, and Quiri, the cadet, have become friends and together explore the dried up bushes. Paraji is very anxious that Kintala bow before him and reconfirm their old hierarchy. Month after month, Kintala has become almost as strong as his father. He tries to rebel, but his revolt seems to him to be so much against nature that he amends it immediately. The agitation of Waka and Quiri that emerges from the brush gives a pretext to Kintala for him to come join them and put an end to the confrontation. To the north, the trees of the mangrove, where the flying foxes have taken up residence, have been transformed into a maternity ward. The females have gathered there to start their gestation period. On a high branch, a newborn, who has just seen the light of day a few minutes earlier, receives from his mother his first grooming. The mother distinguishes herself by a small hole in the edge of her wing. Many of the flying foxes carry similar marks left by the claws of their peers. The silting up of the estuaries in this season of low water makes it so that Salty walks in the mud as often as he swims. However, the color of his leathery scales, heavier and thicker than those of African crocodiles, confuses him with the surface of the murky waters. In a thick layer of aquatic vegetation, some adversaries evaluate each other, as they have done since the time of the dinosaurs. Their morphology has stayed globally unchanged for 200 million years, the same as their primary instincts that give them this order. Fight. In particular, this annoyance ensues from the concentration of the crocodiles, which is stronger when the waters decline. Certain billabongs sometimes become traps where monsters of 18 to 21 feet often pounce. When the war is finished, sometimes a darter appears, a fish-eating bird capable of swimming under the battlefield. On Kangaroo Island, a giant red makes his entrance and will soon create a commotion in Burka's family. Upon his arrival, the others become afraid. Yam, Burka, Cartagena, Pogo. All dread the colossal Scarface. Nevertheless, his intentions do not appear hostile. Nagama, the giant, comes calmly and places himself close to the young Kudla, the only one who didn't see anything, and by Cartagena, sitting upright, and Pogo, vaguely worried. The most troubled is Burka, whose pouch is making her terribly heavy. She escapes. Nagama stands up like a totem pole in the middle of the group. He dominates the world. Even from the sea, one could see his silhouette cut out on the hill. Day after day, Paraji and his kind have consumed the meat of the kangaroo. Some strips of flesh have been pulled up and buried by precaution in order to provide for meager days. Today, Paraji has come with his daughter, Waka, in order to scratch again at some bones, scrape at some tendons, or glean the last pieces of viscera. Colonized by flies and vermin, the carcass is no longer appetizing. Perplexed, Paraji leaves it. Around the kangaroo, he searches vainly for some morsels of dispersed flesh, some that the sun, through dehydration, would have protected from decomposing. Insensitive to the stench that it emits, or attracted by it, Paraji comes back to the carcass. Triumphantly, he finally manages to extract an entrail, which is still edible. The treasure will be placed at the feet of Waka, his daughter, who Kira has recently humiliated without him being able to help her. Waka goes to the offering, sniffs it, and takes it between her teeth. But too much feasting in so few days has had an effect on her appetite. She is disinterested in the gift of Paraji. Burka has escaped upon the arrival of Nagama. She wanted to be in a safe place at the moment when the muzzle of her new baby would appear in the open air for the first time. Burka's baby has opened the slits of its eyes and has moved aside the opening of the pouch as if pushing open the door of the world. His name is Toku, the little one. Another baby attaches itself against the body of its mother. It's Pierced Wings baby, the red flying fox. She cannot spare the baby from some necessary acrobatics. For example, when she wants to urinate, the mother must put herself upside down, placing her head on top. The little hole that the red flying fox carries in her left wing causes her no harm. The wing of the bat is made of a very supple membrane and is solid as well as translucent. The skin that forms regenerates itself in case of need, filling in any perforation. By placing its wing on the mouth of its mother, the baby of Pierced Wing doesn't facilitate this task. But the grooming is soon over, and the newborn will be able to attach itself definitively to one of the teats, thanks to two incisors especially adapted for this task. It will stay attached during the month to come. Thank you. Some males have come back on the tree under cover at dawn. Their presence will be tolerated more than sought after in this time of the year where the colony of females soon transforms itself into a cooperative nursery. Kudla, the young suitor of Kartanya, finally understands that something has happened in the group of gray kangaroos. A giant, a male larger and stronger, is coming between him and the female. Kudla cannot believe that his luck could escape him. He rejoins Kartanya. When he arrives close to her, the female moves away, followed by her son, Pogo. Nevertheless, Nagama, the giant who now accompanies her, did nothing in order to impose himself on her. It seems that his very presence has subjugated Kartanya to the point of making her despise the pale, the colorless, the insignificant Kudla. Again, Kudla attempts a bypass maneuver. He can't admit it. Just when he was so close to obtaining her favors, Kartanya scorns him. But this time, Nagama is nervous and chases him. Kudla can only escape. However, according to the faith of the real men, the Aborigines, a moon is there, in the heavens, to watch over a red flying fox just born, to nurse the wounded harmonies that tear at the people of the dingoes, and to finally heal the despondency of the disenchanted kangaroos.